This is the Bears Barroom Radio Network. The following program is recorded live and intended for all audiences.
This is the National Football League. You got a bunch of owners who inherit the teams, who are members of the Lucky Sperm Club, who are trying to negotiate in 2018 high-tech type of agents. And I just think Ted Phillips and Ryan Pace are overmatched. And I think it's bad for the whole football team. And it's a cloud that hangs over the head of the Bears and Matt Nagy and what they want to do. How many times you heard this? I'm going to Vegas. I go, how'd you do? Well, if I lost $4,000, but you know, you go there to have fun. No, you go there to win. And that's what's wrong with people. They have the negative mentality in anything they do, including sports, before you even laid the bet down. So you gotta be positive. The people that really scare me, the people that can walk in those electric carts. And they go to the slot machine and sit on them. And then they forget that they're supposed to be, you know, crippled from the waist down. Have a bear standing with a towel in his hands, rubbing his crotch. Bear ball washer. What you got to really try to do is money manage and only bet one or two games on a Sunday. That's what we'll be doing on Bear Barroom.
You're listening to the Mike North Advantage, and it begins right now.
That's right, it begins right now. History, that is, the very first Mike North Advantage. I am Mike's sidekick producer, Aldo Gandia. Mike, how are you feeling on this very first Mike North Advantage show?
Well, you know what? I'm definitely, first of all, excited about this. I've done some soft openings before, you know, being in the restaurant business and stuff like that. Although we did our soft opening last week for the Advantage, I think we got all our oars in the water. Now, whether we roam in the same direction, hey, sometimes we might row in different directions, and maybe the boat starts spinning around. But by the end of this show, we're going to give everybody all the information they need here on the Advantage with Aldo and Mike to let everybody know exactly where they stand with the Chicago Bears, exactly where we stand with the Chicago Bears, and we all hope that they do well. But what we're going to have here is a touch of reality. That's what this show is going to be here at The Advantage. A touch of reality. There's plenty of shows on this network. I saw on the Twitter feed, and you can get me at North to North, N-O-R-T-H, number two, N-O-R-T-H, or at Bears Bar Room, or you can check everybody else. I saw the Twitter feeds, and everybody's excited. Everybody's ready to go. And you know what? We still got three more weeks of preseason football because the Bears played the extra game because of the Hall of Fame game. So I'm jacked.
Are you jacked about this Saturday against the Denver Broncos?
Well, yeah, I think we got to see what's going to happen. I think we got to see how these guys are going to perform. We didn't get a good sampling last week with the Bengal game, you know, because what I thought should have happened is that I thought the Bears should have played another series for the first team. What they decided to do is play a couple series or play one series. But if they didn't get a first down, that's why the Kevin White drop was so big. If they didn't get a first down, you know, they just took him off the field. I think that Mitch Trubisky's one of these guys, along with the rest of the offense and defense with new coaches, that needs reps. And I don't think, you know, going into week three, we don't know what anybody can do yet. We're just hearing about what people do in practices, what people do in scrimmages. I heard some good things in the Denver scrimmage. I heard some bad things happen in the Denver scrimmage. You know, you're read in the papers here, Aldo, glowingly, Bears, you know, do well against the Broncos. Three or four Broncos say, Von Miller says, Trubisky the real deal. Let me just tell everybody this. When the other team starts praising you, be worried. Be worried. There was an old manager for the Chicago White Sox. I'll never forget it. He got endorsed by everybody. Jim Leland, Tony La Russa. He's going to be the best. He's going to get it done. And he wasn't bad, but he wasn't how they described him. His name was Gene Lamont. Once, you know, people start talking about a person, a player, a manager that you have in glowing terms, I start worrying because there's a comfort level there. You never heard anybody, you know, talk about Walter Payton like, oh, he's terrific. Everybody knew he was terrific. Nobody had to say it. So when you hear the defense of the Denver Broncos bragging about Mitch Trubisky, be concerned.
Gene Lamont, holy cow.
How do you like that, baby? Well, I threw him out of nowhere, didn't I?
Really?
All I heard is how great he was going to be, and he wasn't bad. but he wasn't what he was supposed to be. And they used to get all these managers coming in. Oh, Lamont's the real deal. Jim Leland, Tony La Russa. You couldn't have gotten a better guy than Gene Lamont. As soon as I hear the opposition start praising us, I worry. I really do.
I hear you. Mike, we are indeed live, and people can hear us on the podcast version after this live program. But if you want to listen to us live, you go over to MixLR.com, and then in the search bar, you type in Bears Barroom Radio Network. We will turn up. We've got a gathering in the chat room. There's also the ability to interact with us. For instance, Charles Prince immediately you wanted to know, is this show safe for work? He wants to play it at his job, and we want to assure him that Mike nor I are going to come up with any dirty language or anything like that. This is not Bears 100 proof where we get a little raunchy. This is a clean version, and we just kind of rely on Mike's irreverence, Mike's hot takes, Mike's sports gambling tips, Mike's historical knowledge of the Chicago Bears, and just a lot of laughs, right?
Well, yeah, Al. I mean, the thing is, like, even when I was doing the radio, I did radio for 25 years. I never hardly swore on the air. This is going to be a show for Bear fans. This is going to be a show for gambling fans. This is going to be a show to try to make some people money. This is going to be a show to give you all the in-depth information you can for the Bears. But we will not use raunchy language. I was never into that. I hear podcasts where people do, which is fine. You know, that's why they're podcasts. You know what? But I was, you know, from the very beginning, 25, 30 years ago, when I started really getting into radio, I was pretty clean. I mean, people find that hard to believe, but a lot of the issues or a lot of the things that happened to me were always issues that were, you know, from bits, from stuff like that. As far as suspensions, which is fine. People, I never was suspended a day in my life on radio. People would think you were suspended forever. I never had an FCC violation. I tried to keep it clean. That's why I have guys coming up to me like 25 years later going, I used to listen to you in my car when I used to ride around with my dad. Now I'm listening to you when I'm riding around with my kids. So I sort of get the chills when that happens, and I understand that we have a responsibility. There's no need to get blue with our show. We'll be blue as it is, believe me, by game six. We will be very blue, ladies and gentlemen, as far as mood is concerned, because I want to see something happen that's going to get everybody jacked up. And we just, last year and so far this year, whether it's Trubisky or any of the Bears, we haven't seen anything to give us hope, to get us jacked up. I'm hoping we see something big tonight. Maybe a guy like Anthony Miller steps out and out of the spotlight, and we just don't hear about the crazy catches in practice. Maybe he actually does it in the games. That's the fear we always have when you're talking about the Chicago Bears. You read about them, you hear about them all week long. Oh, they look good here, they look here. Then they lay an egg on Sunday. Let's hope tonight we have something, or tomorrow night we have something to lay our hands on.
Awesome. We've got George Bayless is in the chat room, and he's so excited that this show is live because he's across the pond. I think he's somewhere in the United Kingdom. I just asked him a question. Maybe he'll respond and let me know exactly where he is. But he's just excited that he can listen to this live. And, yeah, he's in England. He just typed in the chat room. So you've got an international audience.
Worst food in the world, England. Worst food ever. I mean, you know what? I mean, seriously. The bacon stink. Even bacon. They even screw up bacon in England. But been to London. Was there about 20 years ago. Had a good time. Piccadilly Circus, all the fine things. There are big Bear fans out there. If people remember, the very first London game was with the Fridge and the Chicago Bears. So a lot of Bear fans from way back in the day when the National Football League went to London.
Well, George is not arguing the point about the food. He did tell us that he's from Birmingham, which is the Twin City.
Alabama or London?
Birmingham, England.
I know he's from Birmingham, London, right?
Correct. And he says that's the twin city of Chicago out there. So welcome, George, to the chat room. And he says he's absolutely agreed. Absolutely not the worst food, he says. I have some places you can go. So the next time you go to London.
Well, you know what's funny is when you go somewhere 20 years ago, first of all, the TV 20, 25 years ago in London was horrible. They had Sky News and they had soccer. Yeah. There was no iPads. I mean, I would have given anything to have an iPad out there. That's the beautiful thing about the road now for players and for people that go on the road. Back in the day, you sat there in a hotel room for 2 days, bored out of your mind. you know, what's on TV? Maybe we go get something to eat. Now these guys got video games. They got the iPads. They got social media, which they have to be careful on. But it's a whole different ballgame now. So I can imagine he's absolutely right. The food has stepped up. But it's not American food. So let's get that straight right now.
Okay. And George just corrected me. Birmingham is the second city of the United Kingdom. So now let's talk some football. I've got a little bit of sound from Mitch Trubisky. There is a lot of rumblings going on about Cody Whitehair, the center of the Chicago Bears. He's had some issues with his snaps. Apparently, in these Denver practices, he's had several missed snaps. Yesterday, after practice, Mitch Trubisky was asked about that, and this is what he said.
Cody knows I got his back, and Cody cares more about this team and this game than pretty much anybody. So if you guys knew how much Cody loved this game and this team, there wouldn't be any questions about it. So I'm not worried one bit. He's going to continue to work at it. He's got a lot on his plate right now with a lot of calls and checks, as do I. So we're doing a lot of thinking. So the more we can think less and just go out there and play, I mean, he's been practicing, and we're going to get it down. So I'm not worried about Cody one bit. He's a heck of a player, and I love having him on our O-line and our center.
He's one of those guys appreciated. It's hard on himself, though, isn't he?
Yeah, I think the great players are. They never think it's good enough, and no matter what, even if he has a great practice, he never thinks it's good enough. So it's my job just to keep encouraging him, tell him about the good plays, and let him know. Because when you're trying to be great, you're always thinking about the bad plays, but you can't dwell on that. You gotta take a positive from practice away too. So he has gotten better in some areas in this thing. Have we seen some struggles? Everybody does, but it's my job just to let him know I got his back. He's going to continue to get better, and he's really the strength of our O-line up front. He's making a lot of calls, so. It happens. He's going to be fine.
There's nothing worse, Mike, than having your center screw up the snap because the play is basically ruined before the quarterback gets his hands on the ball. Are you concerned about Cody?
At least we've established that he's got his back. He said that 8 times. We understand you got his back. He stinks, okay, as a center. He was moved over from guard. He can't snap. A long snap, a shotgun snap. There's always, even in the practices, even in the scrimmages, there was 2 to 3 mishaps. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know what? If you can't exchange, the one thing, guys, the one thing, folks, that you can't overlook, the center snap should be taken for granted. Would I be right in assessing that for the most part, people think that the snap exchange between the center and the quarterback, whether it's underneath center, or whether it is a shotgun. Would you agree, Aldo, that most football fans say, hey, you know what, that's going to be fine. It's now let's get the handoff off. That's the number one concern in camp. We don't have a center. I didn't think he was that good last year. Granted, he's got a lot of signals to call. Well, he's going to have a lot of signals to call Sunday night against the Green Bay Packers opening day. You know, so you got to be careful there. I think that this is an opportunity for this guy, James Daniels, to maybe go in there. There's other centers in camp. I'd like to see Whitehair moved back to where he was at guard.
The guard position, okay.
I would love to see him move back at guard. I don't think he's going to get it done at center. I think, but the problem is they're in so deep. He's got all the signals. He's doing all the calls. So we're going to at least see game one where we see the center exchanged. So we'll find out down the line. But tomorrow night is a huge night for Cody Whitehair. I mean, I don't think a center has been this scrutinized since, you know, a center in another sport, Will Chamberlain, when he's scoring 100 points a game. This guy is going to be scrutinized. We'll be talking about it next week. The center exchange may be the most important thing we talk about next week. And if there's one, even one. See, a center exchange, would you agree, should be 100% almost all the time, Aldo? It's not. It's like 99%, which means there's going to be a screw-up or two down the line in a game.
You're correct. Now, the thing, I'll use Harp4803's word here in the chat room. It's befuddling to me because Cody Whitehair in his rookie year was thrust into that center position because of injury.
Right.
And he had a Pro Bowl-type year. And he rarely made mistakes. Then, all of a sudden, last year, the bad snaps happened. His blocking was okay, you know, and a lot of people said, well, it's because he'd been moved between guard and center, which is why his performance is not as good as it was in his rookie season. But that just doesn't make sense. And I understand what Mitch Trubisky is saying, that he's got a lot on his plate right now. He's thinking too much about the calls and so forth, and that's going to affect, you know, your performance when you're snapping. But this has to be corrected quickly.
It's got to be corrected quickly, but it hasn't been corrected from last year. and Mitch Trubisky saying to me or to you or anybody, I hear it every year. I've been hearing it every year since I was like 10 years old. He really cares about this team. Every player on the team cares about the team. It's about the performance. You could go up to Matt Nagy, pat him on the back, oh, I'm Cody White here. I love this team more than anybody else. And if you have two bad snaps a game, you got to be out of there. And last year we saw this on a consistent basis. The one thing Mitch Trubisky shouldn't be worried about, especially since he's inexperienced himself, especially underneath center, if he has to go underneath, is the center to quarterback exchange. So let's take a look. Let's see what happens tomorrow night. But if he has one flub, even one flub, Aldo, there's going to be concern. There's going to be concern because it hasn't gone away from last year.
Yeah, it's unfortunately the center position is that position where you make a mistake with the snap, all of a sudden everybody's going to pile on, and that's what's happening to this guy, and you know, there's probably a lot going on in his head, but he's got to fight through this and get it right away.
And I tell everybody this. Can I tell everybody this? I know he's got a lot going on in his head, but it's not exactly. I mean, we're not dealing with scholars here. Olin Kreutz was a center. Okay, I love Olin. Olin's a smart football man and stuff like that. He had a lot going on in his head. This guy called signals, and he was always involved in scrums and everything else. But he was a natural center. Whitehair was a guard. And that's the issue I think we have here. I'd like to see somebody get in there that has more experience. But you know what? They're going to go with this. But remember, you could be going 70 yards down the field. And if you have a bad center exchange with the quarterback and the other team gets the ball, I can't think, besides an interception run back, I can't think of anything worse than a team driving and then the center screwing up to bring a football team down.
Isaiah Robles in the chat room says that you are 100% correct. Yankee Bear 4052 doesn't quite agree. He says every center has bad snaps. It happens. Cody is our guy at center. I don't think he gets moved. And for everyone wanting Daniels moved over, he has struggled with snaps too.
That's true. That's true. But Cody White here, this goes back to last year. So it's not like Nagy just got this guy. You know what I mean, Aldo? It's not like he just got him. So when I hear anybody say on a phone call or in the chat room or anything else, don't worry, he'll be okay, that means you better start worrying. Because that's when somebody starts signaling out. And don't forget Whitehair. How does he handle the pressure of this? I mean, I go back to the days of Mike Pyle from Yale, Olin Kreutz, and every other center in between. Jerry Fontenot was a good center.
Mm-hmm.
They all have to call their signals. So this is something we're going to keep an eye on. But the center position going into week three is one of the top concerns for the Chicago Bears.
Lots and lots of comments in the chat room. Ashley writes, morning, darlings. Can we give Cody some confidence instead of all the negative? Jeesh. What do you say to Ashley?
Well, what I say to Ashley is we're not here to be therapists. We're not here to put a guy on a couch and to lay down. I'm not Dr. Melfi from The Sopranos, you know, dealing with a dysfunctional mafia don. We're dealing with a football player that if he doesn't, this isn't the nice guy show. If he doesn't get the job done, he's got to be out. And Nagy won't waste time. Because don't forget, I know Nagy's on a honeymoon period, but nothing is worse for an offense than at the very thing that starts the offense is the center snap. And when that can't even go right, like I said, it's going to bring down the football team. Now, it's easy for everybody to say now, let's see a bad center snap during the Green Bay game on Sunday night for the first game, and Green Bay covers and scores. Then everybody's going to do a turnaround. I'm with her as far as giving him the confidence he needs, but the confidence has got to start with him, and I think that's the part that's waning.
Excellent. All right, let's move on. Let's talk a little bit about I want to play for you a clip. At the end of Mitch Trubisky's press conference, he gets asked a question by Brad Biggs. I think it's Brad Biggs. I'm not absolutely
Bixby.
Sure.
But he is Bixby. I love Bixby.
Yeah, so you'll probably be able to tell if it's Bixby or not. But here's the interaction between the reporter and Mitch Trubisky.
Preseason results don't matter, but would you like to get some momentum Saturday night?
I'm sorry?
Preseason results don't matter.
They don't matter? Why are you guys talking about it so much?
I haven't talked about it, but...
Yeah, I doubt that.
Would you like some momentum
100%. Every snap matters. Every practice rep, every preseason game matters. And we're coming out here and competing every day, and we're always trying to get better. So no matter what it is, if it's on the practice field, if I'm in the backyard by myself, or if it's a preseason game, we're trying to get better, and we're trying to move the football because that's what great players do. That's what great teams do. So we're just trying to get some momentum and everybody do our job and execute the offense.
Right, thanks, everybody.
Yeah, it was Brad Biggs. I believe it was Biggs. And here's another thing. He's good. He's a good talker. This is what we didn't have with Cutler. So, in other words, you could have something that goes wrong. And, you know, he said momentum four times in that thing. So he uses cliche words, momentum. I have his back when it comes to Cody Whitehair. What he does is he gets off the subject completely, and he just starts saying, you know, we got to do this, we got to do that. But I do like what he said, and I do think he's eager to learn that he said, hey, every snap counts, the preseason counts. That's a writer saying, you know what? What he was really saying was, what's really going to matter is the first game of the season. But what I liked about what Mitch Trubisky said is, hey, you know what? We don't want to hear that. We got to start doing things right now. And that's why I was distressed by the lack of reps last week, but they got three more games to go. So I'm very comfortable with the fact that hopefully by the Green Bay game, the Bears will have everything aligned and ready to go.
Mike, now you are on record as being, maybe the best word is skeptical about Mitch Trubisky's prospects of being a great quarterback in the NFL. Is that the appropriate?
Yeah, I'm not saying he's going to be a bust. What I'm saying is he could be very good. He could be serviceable. But I'm on record, and I brought out something for the Bear Barroom, and I'm going to be doing another video today, do a couple videos a week for Bear Barroom. I'm getting tired, Aldo, of people saying to people, because there's very few of us, the people that, for instance, the people that thought Cutler was going to suck, I was one and there was a few others, you could have put them in a telephone booth and there would have been enough room for a dance floor. Everybody was on Cutler's deal. So I find it amazing. You had a guy that played 8 years for the Bears, came from Denver, and people are more hyped about Trubisky than I seem to be about Cutler. And I'm here to tell everybody that, you know what? We want Trubisky to be great. I want him to be great. But the onus should be on people to tell me why you think he's going to be an all-pro. People keep telling me, well, why do you think he's not going to be all that good? Well, first of all, because of the history of Bears and quarterbacks, there have been very few, whether it's Luckman, whether it's McMahon, Harbaugh, it's sometimes there haven't been a whole lot of them, folks. Mm-hmm. And because of the new team, the new coach, a lot of new players, talent that hasn't come to fruition. I mean, it's good to see that Trubisky and Allen Robinson hooked up a little bit. He hasn't played a whole lot. The kid we got from the Penn State grad who we got from Jacksonville. So, you know what, I want to be positive. I want him to do well. I just think he's got the odds against him right now. Got a bunch of guys around him that are really, really green, and he's still green. He's only played a total of about 26 football games in his whole career from college to pro, and that's just not a big enough sampling size for if you want to get things done.
Well, you make a really good point about the lack of experience, and you mentioned that last week on the show that mm-hmm. you know he hasn't had that many games under his belt, and it takes a while for a quarterback to develop. I mean, Aaron Rodgers sat on the bench two, three seasons watching Brett Favre play, and then when he got in there, it took him a few games to get going, but he finally did, and so. I hear what you're saying about, you know, Trubisky's lack of experience. The good thing, though, is that now you're seeing more and more NFL coaches, and I think you'll see this with Matt Nagy, is implement a lot of college offense stuff to help these young quarterbacks develop more quickly. You're going to see Mitch Trubisky do the RPOs and a lot of stuff that he did at University of North Carolina. So that might help expedite his development. Do you think I'm correct there?
You got a point, but here's what my deal would be. When Aaron Rodgers came here, you had a Hall of Famer playing already in Brett Favre. It would have been nice if they could have drafted Trubisky and Cutler had another year or two on his contract and he actually cared and he actually was good, and he actually wanted to help another quarterback. We didn't see all that. The best thing to do was get him out of there. He had been just a rabid cancer on the team as far as his play had been concerned. The last couple of years, I thought he just mailed it in. I don't think he cared. I think if you watch his reality show, the one that he does with his wife, you see basically what you saw as a quarterback, a guy that's a mope, a guy that didn't want to lead, a guy that basically counted his money, still looking for places to play, but it never came to fruition what he could have been. And I think Mitch Trubisky has enthusiasm, wants to be good, but if we didn't win with Cutler and Martellus Bennett and Brandon Marshall and Matt Forte, you're telling me Trubisky, Howard, and Allen Robinson are going to lead us to the promised land? I don't think so, folks. People forget the Bears had a high-powered offense for a few years there. You had receivers catching 100 balls. You had Matt Forte running for over 4 yards a carry. And what happened? Nothing. Nothing. And I attribute that to the lack of leadership from the top and the lack of leadership from the quarterback position and lack of enthusiasm. And we already know we had the famous halftime tirade where Brandon Marshall got on the table and yelled at the quarterback. We can't have any more of that. So I think it's going to be a process. I really do, Aldo. And there's three quarterbacks. I watched Aaron Rodgers last night. Oh, my God. I mean, I'm not the biggest Aaron Rodgers fan. I think that people tend to put him ahead of Brady and other people. But, my God, last night Green Bay put 52 points on the board. Are the Chicago Bears ready to go? The defense better step up the first game because Aaron Rodgers looked like he was in all-pro form last night.
Yeah, I missed that game. I haven't even looked at the stats, so Rodgers
did well. It was 52-31, Green Bay.
Jeez.
Will the Bears put 52 points up combined for the whole exhibition season?
Oh, Mike, come on. This is a dagger to my heart. Of course they are.
Daggers to the heart. You know what? I understand that. But you know what? I've taken so many daggers to the heart, I got a protective shield around it. Okay?
I hear you. I hear you. Spoken like a true betting man, too.
I was like a true Bear fan.
That, too. Hey, are you sitting around on Sunday nights or whenever that night is that Cutler show is on? Are you sitting around watching that thing?
I have no. I just see a couple. Somebody, all the Cutler ball washers, all the guys that loved Cutler for 8 years, which was 90% of the media and about 90% of the people in Chicago, they were too stupid to realize that he didn't have a clue and didn't care. They're the ones you'll hear the Cutler ball washers going, "He's the real star of the show. This show stinks. He sits there. It's a reality show." I've watched just a couple scenes on Twitter. I would never make Jay Cutler a destination point. I didn't want to make him a destination point on Sunday, but I had to. I'm a Bear fan.
I don't completely agree with you on Cutler. I gotta just say that, you know, I think that yes, he had a couple of seasons where he had some weapons around him, but for the first 6-7 seasons, I mean, you had his number one receiver being Devin Aroma Derushu, whatever his name was, Devin Hester. He had no offensive line. In fact, I got a clip a little later that I'll play for you where your old buddy.
I'm not saying it was all his fault. I'm saying he was the face of the franchise. And when you look back at his 8 years, you can finger point at him. You'll finger point at John Fox. You'll finger point at some of the offense.
Mm-hmm.
But you know what? Those 2-3 years that they were putting up all sorts of numbers, and then you see his offensive players wanting to kill him. I knew right there he wasn't bought in. And then when they gave him the extension, you know, I'm glad it's over with. I'm glad we got Mitch. He's the opposite of Cutler. He's a sunshiny day. But will he be able to put up points? Will he be able to have the see, he doesn't have a receiver like Cutler had around him. He has no receivers like Cutler had for a few years around him, like a guy like Brandon Marshall. Mm-hmm. Doesn't have anybody like that. Hopefully Allen Robinson could fill that void. He had one catch last year before he got hurt, but the year before he put up some big numbers, so we'll see what happens.
Now, last night here on the Bears Ballroom Radio Network, Buffon 55 started his.
I like him.
Yeah, he's good, right? Well, I want to play a clip. I asked him a question about Bears wide receivers. Does he think that they're better this year than they were last year? And this was his response, and then I want you to follow up. This is about 60 seconds long. Here we go.
Allen Robinson is better than Kendall Wright. Taylor Gabriel is better than Josh Bellamy. Anthony Miller is better than Dontrell Inman. A bag of actual wheat is better than Marcus Wheaton. And let me go off on Kevin White for a second. Kevin White were not a first-round pick. Let's say he was a second-round pick. He would not be garnering so much forgiveness from Bears fans. If he were a second-round pick, he would be an afterthought 2 years ago by the fans. I don't think I'm saying anything profound here, but first-round receivers don't work out all that often. Let me throw you some names. Laquon Treadwell, Cordarrelle Patterson, Justin Blackmon, Michael Floyd, Buster Davis. You even know who that is? First of all, and then the odds aren't good for these guys to really pan out. And I'm supposed to be impressed because Kevin White is a physical freak. Anybody remember Vernon Golston from Ohio State? He looked like he was chiseled from marble and he couldn't play dead in a Western. So can he play? I'm talking about Kevin White. I say no, and maybe it's time for someone else to get a shot. No one was saying, let's give Chris Williams another shot. Remember the lineman from Vanderbilt that was supposed to jive with Jay Cutler? You know why they didn't give him a shot? Because he sucked. No one said, hey, let's see if how Gabe Carini plays out. You know why? Because he sucked. Was anyone saying, hey, let's pump the brakes on Shane McClellan. Let's see how he's going to do. No one said that. You know why? Everybody in unison now, because he sucked. So let's just say, let's pump the brakes on Kevin White forgiveness. The guy can't play, and it might be time to put somebody else in there.
What do you think of John Buffon's take on
a lot of good stuff that John said, a lot of great stuff that John said. A couple things. Anthony Miller has shown me nothing yet. John's got him as Jerry Rice already. He had a catch for minus 1 yard last week. Let's slow the roll down on the rookie. We've been hearing a lot of good things about him, but I'm going to tell everybody straight up, we don't know what he can do. He's a former walk-on from Memphis with a chip on his shoulder, but minus 1 yard for one catch, I'm not ready to put him as a starter even yet. Granted, the receivers they had last year were horrible, but saying the receivers you got this year are better than semi-pro receivers you had last year isn't a vote of confidence. It's a vote of concern. So what I would say is I want to see him do it on the field. I mean, we hear a lot of things. I see Anthony Miller making all sorts of strides and making some circus catches in practice. Hey, look, the list is long of Bear receivers and Bear running backs who have been successful against Bear defenses in practice. Let's see him do it in the game before we start anointing people like Anthony Miller and other people they are apparent. And I know what John's talking about. I mean, based on potential, I do love this receiving core better than I loved it last year. But here's the point that I would like to make. Between the four top receivers that the Bears have, most of them couldn't be starting receivers in the National Football League on other teams. And between the four of them, they have 325 total plays. That's not green. That's dark green. That's swampy green. So you know what? There's experience that needs to be had, and the only way you get it is being on the field. And that's why last week I thought a team this young with a young coaching staff, I don't want to do what everybody else is doing, Aldo. Oh, let's only play one series because Denver's playing one series. Or let's only play a half. I thought that the first string from the second game on should play one half. And if somebody gets hurt, they get hurt. It's football. But you don't have the luxury with a bunch of new players and new receivers to play a set of downs where you throw four times, complete two for 4 yards and go, we're good, and then you never see him again.
You don't think that Allen Robinson is a starter in the NFL?
I think he's a starter in the NFL, but between them they have 325 catches. He's a starter because of the year before. We don't even know if he's going to last the season. He's going to play tomorrow night, from what I understand. He didn't play at all. They're taking him. They're coddling him. In fact, I'm sure there's people that don't want to even see him play next week. But he had one catch last week, so he was a starter year before. But when you blow a tire the next year, then you got to figure out if he's going to have starter speed, starter this. I think he will. He better, because Ryan Pace put a ton of money into damaged goods.
Yeah, it definitely is a concern. I mean, he's coming off an ACL. They're not rushing him back. He's going to probably see a couple of series on Saturday night against the Denver Broncos. Not much more than that.
I want to see him catch a pass and see what he does with it. And I'm with you. You know what? I think he'll be a starter. But this isn't, you know, a bunch of Bear fans getting together and go, well, he had a good year 2 years ago. What about last year? What happened last year? Well, he got injured and he blew his knee out. Are you serious now? That's what we're pinning our hopes on? I mean, and plus, don't forget, Jacksonville, he got hurt. They made the playoffs without him.
Mm-hmm.
They made the playoffs without him. How did they make the playoffs, Aldo, without the great Allen Robinson last year?
Yeah.
And with Blake Bortles. So that gives you hope. That gives you hope. But I'm not going to sit here and say he's going to have 70 catches because they still say, according to reports I'm reading, is he still coming back from the injury. So he's not 100% yet. We're going to get a better bearing Saturday night. We didn't get anything against the Bengals. Would you agree? We didn't get a whole lot of play against the Bengals who did this and who did that. We didn't really get anything. I think tomorrow night we'll get more of an idea.
Well, and to be clear, Matt Nagy has said that everything that is happening in preseason games is in anticipation for getting ready for week one. It's not about winning games. It's about first player evaluation, making sure you've got the best 53 for week one, and it's about making sure that the players who are coming back from injury are working their ways to 100% for that week one matchup against the Packers. So I don't begrudge or bemoan Nagy's decision not to play Allen Robinson in the second preseason game. Now, yeah, we have to see him in action. We've got to see him, you know, two or three passes targeted his way in this third preseason game. And then in that all-important fourth preseason game, which would be normally the third preseason game if it wasn't for the Hall of Fame, then he's got to go out there for three solid quarters. We got to see him block. We got to see him cut. We got to see him make catches. We got to see him go up high and contest for a ball and win those battles. Yeah, I'll feel a heck of a lot better about that investment after that game three and if Allen Robinson comes through as expected by the Bear ball washers.
Here's another thing. I don't care if they even play Jordan Howard tomorrow. I see Jordan Howard. If he goes down, they're screwed, period. End of story. Jordan Howard is the most important member of that Bear offense, even more than Mitch Trubisky, because what Jordan Howard does is that he gives you the play-action type of situation that buys Mitch Trubisky more time. He gives Mitch Trubisky a bona fide Pro Bowl type of quarter of running back in the backfield that the other team has to be worried about. I think the guy that I want to see go to the next level, we haven't talked a whole lot about him. It's been very quiet. He hasn't run a whole lot in camp, is Tariq Cohen. I'm anxious to see how Nagy uses Cohen. From what I'm understanding, he's using him in a lot of passing sets. But I think he's got the ability to run 8, 9, 10 times a game as an offshoot from Jordan Howard, the big, you know, the lumbering back that can run over people. You got this little scat back, this Darren Sproles type back. They're throwing the ball to him. They have him in the slot a lot. They have him, spreading out. I want to see him run the football in this game also, and I want to see some screenplays.
Excellent. I got to tell you that Harp4803 in the chat room says, damn, Mike North is ruining my Bear ball washing dreams.
I'm not out here to hurt nobody. Here, look, I love when people say I want, you know, exhibition record and this and that doesn't mean anything. And I people harken back to the Bears of 85. The 85 Bears that won the Super Bowl only won one exhibition game. Okay, they were 1-3 that year. The year before, though, they played the San Francisco 49ers in the NFC finals. So you understand that we weren't worried about an exhibition record of a team that was on their way to the Super Bowl, almost made it the year before. No, we're worried about a win. I think the Bears do need a win in these next three games because they don't have the cachet of the 85 Bears. This is a brand new team, and I don't care what anybody says. A win takes a lot of pressure off, and if anybody thinks Matt Nagy, really, even if the games have been close like the previous two, anybody thinks that Matt Nagy, who thinks exhibition games are just to get ready for the first game, anybody thinks he wants to go into the season 0-5 is out of their minds. It's out of their minds. The Bears do need at least one win to show the players the worst thing you can do is look good and then be 0-5 going into the season. So I do want to win. I think they're going to get a win. I think the two games they played against Baltimore and Cincinnati have been very close. They've covered the games. So they're knocking on the door. I think the players are anxious to get out there themselves. I think the Bears are being a little bit overly cautious about certain players, but I have no problem with it because, you know what, I'd like to see Trubisky get more time. Anybody else like Howard and Tariq Cohen, maybe some of the other mainstays, if you want to rest them, that's fine with me because you're right. You can't win anything in the third week of the exhibition season.
Good stuff, Mike North. Excellent stuff. Listen, let's change gears.
I actually did my homework. I studied for 2 days. I mean, I feel like I'm back in the fifth grade.
I'm glad you're
Come
not,
on now.
I'm glad you're not sitting around watching Killing Cavallari with Jay Cutler.
I can't do it. I didn't want to see the guy run on the field for the Bears. Why would I turn him on, for some a show at night? But, you know, there's certain people that I guess love the mopedom. It was the mopedom of Jay Cutler. I wish Jay Cutler would have had Trubisky's personality and his gear. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, you know, that definitely was a problem. I mean, the memes on Jay Cutler, the smoking Jay Cutler memes with him smoking a cigarette in the
hall. Let me ask you something. I mean, if the Gerber baby always scowled, if you know the Gerber baby, the one that's always laughing on the little jar of baby food?
Yeah.
Put a sad face on him. You think you're selling as many? No. Put a sad face on the Gerber baby. Jay Cutler was the sad face Gerber baby. Mm-hmm. Did you ever hear Jay Cutler laugh out loud? Belly laugh, ever?
No.
It's almost, I belly laugh every day. I never heard the guy belly laugh.
Yeah.
Did you ever hear him laugh like that? No. He has no personality. He wasn't a leader. He put up big time. He was a stat stuffer who made himself a lot of money. God bless him.
Well, good for him. All right, I want to shift gears here and go back into the past, a little maybe further back than Jay Cutler's past. You know, Draft Dr. Phil has been doing a really cool job on Twitter doing these polls of who wore it best and so forth. But there's been a couple of times where the poll results, for me, a nearly 60-year-old Chicago Bears fan, the poll results have been disheartening because there's been some old-timers who have just been overlooked and disrespected. Now, I totally understand people, you know, saying that Jordan Howard, number 24, wore it best, but please give some respect to J.D. Caroline, right? I mean, you saw the guy play. Tell us about J.D. Caroline.
J.C. Caroline was one of the great special teams players back in the 50s and 60s, University of Illinois, one of the great players out of the University of Illinois. First of all, let me say this about Dr. Phil and Shane and Bear Girl. I've never seen, and all the other people, John Buffon, I've never seen a group of people that want to see something succeed so badly, put all their time in, and you, from dusk to dawn, working on artwork, working on graphics, doing stuff for the Twitter. I mean, it's just not putting a podcast on now. It's trying to incorporate it with social media. I'm very impressed with everybody here, and I love it. I love the work Phil does. Phil has this thing from 99 down. Sometimes it looks like it's going to be a normal, like there's no vote taken, like for Peyton, 34, mm-hmm. Dan Hampton, 99. But there have been a couple. And let's face it, J.C. Caroline played 50, 60 years ago. But there's no way Jordan Howard in his second year is better than a guy who played in the championship in 56 and played for the Bears in 63.
Right.
I saw him take out four guys on a kickoff return on a rolling block when rolling blocks were successful. Now, I'm not telling people I'm old, but I actually saw J.C. Caroline play for the Bears. He was a tenacious football player. I thought that he should have beaten out Jordan Howard. I don't know if he beats out Jordan Howard at the, 2-3 years down the line, but I also say this in defense of anybody that votes for Jordan Howard. He's not chopped liver, and let's face it, most of the people that saw J.C. Caroline play, including Mike Ditka, are these guys that are in their 60s or 70s or dead. So I don't have a problem with it. I just think that J.C. Caroline should have won that one. I think there's been a couple other ones that were overlooked, but for the most part, hey, Phil just puts the vote out there. Could it be explained better? I don't know. Would it help? I don't know. I don't think it would help all that much anyway. Even if you gave the history, people are for the here and now, and that's the way it goes.
Mike, I need to apologize. I actually got that right. It was Rosie Taylor that beat out Jordan Howard for number 24, and then it was Brad Musker
right.
who beat out J.C. Caroline.
Brad Musker, who averaged 4 yards a carry, beat out J.C. Caroline.
Right.
Who wore 25.
Right.
Okay. And then he beat him out, and I looked at Brad. Brad Musker was out of Stanford. Brad Musker was brought out of a he was more of a straight-up running back. He had a running style like Eric Dickerson. If you see Eric Dickerson, and I'm not comparing him to Eric Dickerson, but if you see Eric Dickerson run, it was straight up.
Yep.
No head down like Walter used to do, put the head down and punish people.
Mm-hmm.
Brad Musker was a 4-yard carry back.
Yeah.
Last year, that was what Jordan Howard was, too. So, you know, I want to see more of that. But Brad Muster played 6, 7, 8 years with the Bears. Pretty good football player. Rosie Taylor played for the 63 Bears, was a safety. But, in you know what, outside of linebacker, Aldo, middle linebacker and running back, the Bears have been very solid throughout their history at safety, whether it be Gary Fencek, Todd Bell. Todd Bell got beat out by Brad Muster. Todd Bell was a great football player.
He was, yeah.
Who wore number 25 for the Chicago Bears. Played defensive back. What happened to Brad Muster was what happened to Todd Bell was he sat out his Super Bowl year. How's that for timing?
Yeah, that was awesome.
And Dave Duerson got the opportunity to take his place, and they ended up winning the Super Bowl. And Todd Bell was never the same again, him and Al Harris, who both sat out in the Super Bowl year. I felt so bad for those guys. But then I said, they tried to screw my season up. They held out. Listen to Zelda, a full season.
Yep.
Or they? Can you believe that during a Super Bowl year? You would never see that today. And so I got to say this to Phil. He does a great job. And he doesn't do the voting. I think Bear fans aren't as well-versed as they used to be. I don't think the Bears tried to do a pretty good job with their history, but I'd like to see the Chicago Bears accentuate their history a little bit more because they have more Hall of Famers than anybody else in the game of football.
I totally agree that I think part of the reason that we're seeing these odd results is that the franchise doesn't do a good job of sharing the history of the team. They need to, you know, and they're doing a much better job in social media of promoting this year's team than they have in years past, where we were very critical of their social media department. Now they've got some new people in there, and they're doing a great job. Now, especially in when the off season happens, I'd love for them to step things up and share with the young people who follow the Chicago Bears information about, you know, the Carolines and the Rosie Taylors and the Terry Schmidt. You brought up Terry Schmidt, number 44.
Terry Schmidt was number 44. He should have gotten some votes. He's still alive. He's a dentist. He played pretty decent at cornerback, and we were going best number 44s. You know, it just, look, looking back, when you look at the history of the Bears, I mean, how many people know who Bill Osmanski was? I mean, the other day I brought it up on Twitter. Look, I like Jordan Howard. But he's about the 10th, 11th greatest Bear running back ever. I mean, you have Peyton, you have Sayers, you have Bill Osmanski, you had Bronco Nagurski, you had Red Grange, you have Gale Sayers. I mean, you even have Brad Muster, who had similar numbers his first couple of years to Jordan Howard, who could catch the ball out of the backfield. You look at Matt Forte. Look at all the great Bear running backs. So Jordan Howard has to play 2, 3, 4 more years for me to go, man, he's all that, because I've seen all that. I've seen Sayers and Peyton. You got to go a long way before you impress me, son. That's what I would say, Jordan Howard, and start impressing me starting this year. Last year, he impressed me, went down a little bit, but they loaded him up. He still gained 1,000 yards, although 1,000 yards today, Aldo, with 16 games is nothing.
Yeah,
you know, when we were kids, it was 12 games and 14. If you get 1,000 yards in 14 games, I'm good. You get 1,000 yards in 16 games, what is that, 50 yards a carry?
Yeah,
55, 60 yards, a game?
Mm-hmm.
That's not good enough. I'd like to see in a 16-game season, 1,200 yards be the barometer for running backs.
I'm with you there. I'm
totally God, am I on my game today. Man!
You're on fire.
Damn.
Nobody is arguing with you on
I'm arguing with myself. I do it on a frequent basis. I got in an argument the other day with myself and lost. Telling you.
What about when you and BB argue? Who wins the host?
I lose twice. Me and BB will be. We don't argue that much anymore. We put a couple days on the calendar. We go at it for about 5 minutes, then we wear out and go to sleep.
That's the way to do it.
Oh, absolutely. Hey, I didn't last 40 plus years because, hey, look, people, I'm not the sharpest pencil in the box, but I do know this. If you get along, it's a lot easier.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and you know you're a happily married man.
Yeah, it took me a while to get it right, a couple of tries, but...
Oh, did you really? You've been multiple times?
Oh, yeah, I...
Oh, so you're like Eddie Fisher. You're like all the big stars back in the day.
Eddie Fisher married the famous singer from the, 50s and
60s? First of all, Eddie Fisher married the trifecta of trifectas. He married Debbie Reynolds, Connie Stevens, and Elizabeth Taylor.
Wow.
There's not another man alive that could have pulled that triumphant off, ever. Three just... I mean, Connie Stevens is like in her 70s. She's still hot.
I know what I'm saying? I saw a picture of her
Debbie
recently.
Reynolds, you know?
Yeah. I was like amazed. That's Connie
Listen,
Stevens.
I was at the Caesars Palace one night. I'm throwing dice.
Mm-hmm.
I look up, and there's a guy in a white suit across the way, you know, at the other end of the crap table. I'm throwing dice. I look up, there's a guy in a white suit with a red shirt and a red handkerchief coming out of his pocket. Sort of small. Short guy. Looks like he's in his 70s, got a bad hair dye job. I go to my buddy, I go, you know who's that? He goes, who? I go, that's Eddie Fisher. I went over there, stopped rolling the dice, I gave the dice to somebody else. I talked the guy's ear off for 5 minutes. You know what I mean? He didn't want any, he wanted to just move on, but he was so impressed that I recognized him and stuff like that. I go, you know what? In the 50s, and 60s, he was hot as anybody. 50s and early 60s, as hot as anybody. Movie star, music, married to Elizabeth Taylor, Debbie Reynolds, and Connie Stevens. Can you imagine those three?
Unbelievable.
Take a look at them, folks. You know, get away from the bear stuff. Look up those three girls and say, why wasn't Eddie Fisher tired? My God.
That's hilarious.
I'm telling you.
Hilarious. All right, Mike, we've got about 10 minutes left. Let's turn our attention to some picks. Last week you were 1-1. What do you got for us this week? Make us some money.
Well, you know what, Aldo? I know that you're not the biggest gambling man.
No, I'm not.
You're a guy that you want to see the Bears win. But what we're going to do this year is we're going to try to get two wins for the price of one. The Bears are going to win, and then the Bears are going to cover for us.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, first of all, you got Denver -3. Tomorrow night against the Chicago Bears. You know what? I'll leave the Bear game last.
Okay, good.
I'll leave the Bear game last. I'm going to throw the tease out there. I'll leave the Bear game last, and we'll have some fun with tonight's games. Now, I'm having trouble finding my picks here because if I don't have my picks, kill some time, Aldo. I got to find my picks.
All right, well.
Kill some time. recite the Gettysburg Address. Let me go to the sheet because I got it off.
I will tell our listeners that here on Bears Ballroom Radio Network, during the season, we're going to offer multiple shows. We're going to have a couple of shows, a pre- and post-game show on game mm-hmm. days. On Monday nights, it's Bears Hour Live with Draft Dr. Phil, moderated by Bears Girl. On Wednesday, we've got Bears 100 Proof. We've also got a fantasy football show called The Goon Show for you fantasy football players. And we've got Buffon 55. And, of course, we've got the Mike North Advantage. We've got you covered with wall-to-wall
Bears program. Yeah, Buffon 55. Buffon brings it.
Man,
he brings it,
too. Man, last night I could not fall asleep because it was like he was throwing caffeinated energy at me, and I was up for 3 hours after the show because the guy just is a blast of energy. He's a lot like you.
Well, you know what? And he says a lot. The Kevin Wright thing, I want to just say this right now.
Mm-hmm.
They want that experiment to work so bad, and I don't know why. Okay, it's not against the rules to have a bum pick, okay? And you want it? It's sort of like they're force feeding this guy down our throat, and it's really, you know what? Big. This is the most important preseason of this guy's life,
mm-hmm.
of Kevin White's life. He's got three games now.
Yep.
If he drops one more pass in a key situation, because if he catches that pass last week, we keep the drive going and Trubisky stays on the field.
Right.
If he drops another pass, I think he's done. If he can't get open, if he has a bad game tomorrow night, the clock is ticking. Now, I got the games here, my friend.
All right.
I got. You know what I'm going to do tonight?
Okay.
I'm going to throw more than one game at everybody. We got games tonight, and then we got the game with the Chicago Bears and the Denver Broncos coming up also. The first game, okay, is the Detroit Lions against the New York Giants, okay? The Lions are giving the New York Giants 3. Barkley already a little bit dinged up. Saquon Barkley's already dinged up. They're not going to play a lot of their guys. The Detroit Lions are at home. Barkley is probable for tonight's game. You got Stafford going to get a little bit of work. I'm taking the Giants, though. I'm taking the Giants. I just think that it's going to be a close football game. The Giants +3 to start things off. Write these down.
I'm writing.
And then after I see him next week, I'll ask you to erase those picks. No, I'm just kidding. So I got the New York Giants tonight against the Detroit Lions, which to me I think is going to be a low-scoring game. When you think of the Giants and Lions, you think of Matthew Stafford. Don't forget, the over-under is 40.5 in this game. I wouldn't do anything with that. Take the New York Giants plus the 3. Another game I like tonight is Miami and Carolina, the total, 43. You know, they got Cam Newton. You know, remember, these are defenses that are trying new people. And if, with preseason football, Aldo, I would tell everybody this. If you bet $100 a game for preseason, bet 50. If you bet $200 a game for preseason, bet 100. Just cut your bet in half. Not that you're going to lose the game, or not that I'm going to give you a loser. I'm going to try everything I can to give you a winner. Last week I go 1-1. I had Atlanta, but I also had the under on the show. I'm stepping out tonight, but I'm telling everybody to keep their bets cut in half. So I got Miami under the 43. I also have the Giants plus the 3 in the football game. And one more game.
Okay.
Who's being hyped more than anybody? Now, there's 5 games tonight. I'm not going to play a couple of them. I give you the Giants. I'm giving you the under in the Dolphins game.
Right.
Who's everybody talking about? Cleveland.
Cleveland
Everybody's
Browns.
Talking about Cleveland. Baker Mayfield looking good. Hugh Jackson has the team playing hard. They're putting on a show for the TV cameras. That being said, Cleveland is playing the Buffalo Bills. Cleveland, listen to this, folks. The Cleveland Browns are giving 3.5 points. I'd like to stay with the Cleveland Browns, but they haven't shown me that they're worthy of giving anybody points. I'll take Buffalo plus 3.5. So those are the 3 games that I'm giving everybody tonight. I stepped out, Aldo, because that's what we do here on Bear Bar.
I love it. I'm going to call Frankie out in Vegas. No, I'm not.
Oh, you got a guy named Frankie in Vegas? What's his last name? The Nose? Frankie the Nose?
Actually, his name is Norm.
you just made to call Frankie to throw
yeah.
us off.
Well, yeah, of course. Throw off the those guys who listen.
Yeah, let them give them, you know what, if I had to pick the strongest pick of the night, if I had to take, here, I got, I'll even title the picks, okay?
Mm-hmm.
This is the buffet pick, okay? The New York Giants. Once you win this bet, you can go to any all-you-can-eat buffet and just load up, okay? the Aldo Gandia, we're kicking ass at Bear Barroom pick, will be the under 43 in the Miami-Carolina game.
That's the one
right?
I like. That's the
and
one.
And then the one game that's called, I wish the NBA was on instead of me betting this game. I'd rather watch the Atlanta Hawks versus the Miami Heat, the Buffalo Bills getting 3.5, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, I can't believe that. We're talking about the Bills. And
I'm getting jacked, buddy. I get jacked on preseason football.
Awesome. All right, let's talk about the Bears-Broncos. What's the spread there, and what's your advice?
The Chicago Bears, ladies and gentlemen, have done well. They covered the first game against Baltimore. They pushed the game against Cincinnati. It pushes when you tie. Let's say you got the Indianapolis Colts minus 3, and you know, and they play a team like Cleveland, and Indianapolis wins 27-24. That means that you landed on the number. That's called, in the business, a push. Mm-hmm. We don't want a push. Now, there could be a push because the Chicago Bears are 3-point favorites. 3-point dogs. Denver is a 3-point favorite, and the over-under is 40 in that game. I'm going with the Denver Broncos. I just think they're going to be charged up. They're going to be playing on their home track. I think the Bears are still a young team. And when you hear Bear players or Matt Nagy saying, we're not worried about winning exhibition games, I think John Elway and Denver would like to win this exhibition game. So I'm going to go with the team that wants to win and isn't, you know, wants to establish something. While the Bears right now are still searching, I'm going to take the Denver Broncos minus the 3. As much as it chagrins me, my friend, as much as it chagrins me.
Now, how, when you bet against your team, the team that you love, the team that you've been
the worst.
The team that you've been following since, what, 1960, that's got to feel terrible, right? That you're placing
until you find out, until you start figuring out. Since 19, I started really laying down money when I was like 15, 16. I was on a payment plan for $50 back in the day. When you're 14 years old, you know, I had to pay the guy like $10 a month and stuff like that. Nobody's cost Bear fans more money in their lifetime, whether it be a mortgage, a car payment, or a big restaurant bill, more than the Chicago Bears. Because most of us bet with our hearts. So I learned about 5-6 years ago, look, if the Bears lose a game, fine. You know, you can be disappointed. But when they say you won $500 or $200 because you bet against the Bear, it sort of eases the pain. It's sort of like that bandage that you put over the wound. It's sort of like the cream that helps meticulize the the cut. So you know what? As much as I want to see the Bears win, if the Broncos win by 10 and the Bears show improvement, plus I cover the game, I'll be happy tomorrow.
Awesome. Okay, Mike, offer up.
Amy just gave me the thumbs up. She just came in from walking the dog. Uh-huh. She's listening to the show live. She just gave me the thumbs up. That's good.
All right, we got BB's endorsement.
Thumbs up.
Thank you, BB. I'm going to play the closing theme music. Mike, offer up a final thought.
Let's go, Bears. Let's see some improvement. I don't care if they win 50-0 or if they lose 50-0. If we see some improvement, although I don't think you'll see much from a 50-0 loss, but if we see improvement tomorrow night and we can actually legitimately say this guy did this guy did that without sounding like ball washers, I'll be happy.
Heart 4803 in the chat room says, hello, BB, and from all of us at Bears Barroom, all the barflies are saying, welcome to the family, Mike North and BB. We love that you are a part of our radio network, and the videos will start coming soon. The videos are called The Edge.
Well, we already did one this week. We're doing another one today. We're going to have it up on the page soon, but I'll be doing videos on Twitter and everything else. Let me do my Harry Carey. So long, everybody.